And without further ado, I'd like to introduce tonight's speaker, which I believe is going to talk about chocolate. So I'm surprised that there's not more people here. Yes, a big round of applause for chocolate. So tonight's speaker is Scott Askinosie, and he is the Director of Science and Technology at Askinosie Chocolates. And he'll tell you much more about them than that. And he's also our first graduate student speaker that we've had, because he's a graduate student in the Department of Biological Sciences working on photobiology. And so without further ado, here's Scott.
Thank you. Well, thank you all for coming. Before I get started, I would like to thank Jason and Jason and the Science Cafe. This is a really, really cool thing that they do. And it seems like it's really getting the word out about science to people who wouldn't normally be involved in science, and which I think is really important. So if you guys wouldn't mind, can we give them a short round of applause? We're doing such a great job. The way that I'd like to do this is I could talk about chocolate all night long. So in order for you guys to get the most out of this, I would like to talk about what you want to talk about. So I'm going to go through the process from start to finish on how to make chocolate. And if you guys have a question or if there's something else that you would like to know, please feel free to raise your hand and ask a question, because there is a lot of science behind chocolate. And there are some really interesting things that go into it, that go into the actual production, that go into the flavor, that go into the texture, all of the important things that make chocolate chocolate. So, without further ado, I'm gonna start at the beginning. Something that maybe not everyone knows is that the chocolate actually begins as a tree. And as a tree, it exists in the wild, and it is very susceptible to a lot of things. So since we're talking about science, and since we're talking about chocolate, I would like to talk about where the science begins, and that is with the tree. So plants are exposed to a lot of different things in the environment, and some of the things they're exposed to are disease, to parasites, to, you know, changes in heat, changes in temperature, changes in wind. And there are genes that will allow the trees to be more resistant to those things. So an interesting thing about cacao, which is the tree or that chocolate grows on, is that it's an orphan crop. And what an orphan crop means is that, unlike corn or wheat or the other traditional crops that you think of, there isn't a lot of financial backing for research for the cacao plant. So whereas corn, there are thousands of researchers all over the United States alone working on it, and there are funds available for it, it's not like that for cacao. And cacao, which makes cocoa, it's a commodity that's involved in a lot of the processing of many of the foods we eat, which we don't typically think about. So there are a few people doing research on cacao, one of which I'm going to mention, who is a friend of mine and a very close friend of the factory at Sublime, who have really dedicated their lives so that chocolate is something that we can enjoy and that our children and our children's children can enjoy as well. Because certain plants, certain trees, are more susceptible than others, and some are resistant. For instance, about a decade ago, there was a disease called witch's broom that decimated about 60 to 80% of all cacao trees throughout Central and South America. And witch's broom is a fungus that some trees are resistant to and some trees are susceptible to. So one of the things that Ed worked on was he wanted to breed these trees to be resistant for or against witch's broom without breeding out the important genes that are responsible for flavor or for texture, so that we didn't end up with a chocolate that was either dead because it got sick, or we had chocolate that lived but didn't taste very good. And Ed was the lead of the R&D department at Mars for a very long time. And he and Mars Chocolate worked together to sequence the genome of cacao using their own private funds because there aren't public funds available. And they wanted to make this open source so that everyone could have access to this, so that other researchers that wanted to pick up the torch could see through the genome sequence, which is the DNA of the plant and all the genes involved, the genes that are important for things like disease research, and the genes that are important for things like flavor, so that when we're working with these plants, we don't breed out the genes responsible for flavor and they're lost forever. So really the science of cacao begins at the tree, and there are measures that they can use to selectively choose for genes that will make the plant not only bigger, better, faster, stronger, like we typically see in corn, but also so that it still tastes good and it still has those chocolate characteristics that we're used to. And by sequencing the genome, it made it occur so much faster, because it really expedited the process, because cacao is a tree, and some trees it can take 6 months to 2 years to reach a state where they're mature enough to actually produce a fruit, and the fruit which makes the cocoa bean, which makes chocolate. So by sequencing the genome, rather than waiting 2 years to see if the plant produces a fruit that tastes good, or growing a tree and then saturating it with something like witch's broom and seeing if it dies, they can take a seedling and take a little piece of leaf and put it into a tube and read its DNA, and they can tell on the spot if this tree is susceptible to witch's broom or if the tree is going to produce fruit that tastes good. So if it weren't for people like this that really cared about cacao and really cared about chocolate, chocolate could be something that's very realistically in the future wouldn't exist anymore. In fact, there are a group of people that speculate that within the next 7 years, due to the increase in demand for chocolate, that chocolate may be something that becomes too expensive for the average person to afford. Because there are markets in China and in India where they have a growing middle class that are beginning to have a taste for chocolate. And when you increase that demand without increasing the supply, it raises prices. So people like Ed Sulgoin are really hoping to keep that at an affordable range so that, you know, people like us can continue to enjoy chocolate. So the science of chocolate really begins at the tree. And the tree produces a fruit, which most people probably wouldn't think of. And that fruit exists as a pod. And here is an example of a cacao pod. This is where chocolate comes from. Now this is a dry preserved pod. The pod in real life would look something a little bit more like this. And this is fake, but it looks good. So the pod on the tree is removed by the farmers. And inside of this pod are the seeds, or the cocoa beans as we know them. And these beans are surrounded by this decadent pulp. And the pulp is this, it's white, and it's viscous, and it's milky, and it tastes wonderful. It's sweet, and it makes excellent smoothies. You can put it in your cereal, it's really great. But we can't get a lot of the pulp here in the United States because cacao only grows near the equator. It will only thrive between the Tropic of Cancer and the Tropic of Capricorn. So that's 20 degrees south and 20 degrees north of the equator. So if you can imagine getting a fruit from there all the way to here, which unfortunately, unlike some of the other fruits we get from the tropics, can't be ripened in root, it's very difficult. That and it's so sweet and viscous that there are a lot of other things that like to eat it as well, like bacteria. So if you ever get a chance to try this, it's really, really great, and you will love it. Because of that, Mother Nature has ingrained into this fruit a very ingenious tactic for spreading these seeds. And that is, the pulp is wonderful. So animals will seek this out. Animals will break open the pods and they will suck the pulp. But when they get to the seed, the actual cocoa bean, it is very bitter. It's very astringent. So they will be sucking on the pulp, but they will spit the bean out. And by this way, Mother Nature or evolution has really cemented the fact that these seeds get spread out. Because on their own, they really don't taste as good as the pulp. So naturally, an animal is gonna wanna eat the pulp, discard the seed, thereby spreading the tree so that it grows. But we're talking about chocolate, so we're interested in the bean. So how do we make chocolate? Well, we begin by removing the pulp from the pod. And the pulp is then put into a large wooden box, and it begins the fermenting process. So in order to make chocolate, or actually rather, in order to process the beans so you can make chocolate, there are a few steps that we need to do. First of all, the beans must be fermented. Then they're dried. Then they're typically shipped to the factory where the chocolate is made, where they're roasted. We make cocoa liquor, cocoa butter, and then they're mixed, tempered, and made into chocolate. So we're gonna go through each one of those steps in order. And we're gonna follow the journey of the bean all the way from the pod to the chocolate bar. And the first step is fermentation. And many people consider the fermentation step as the first step of flavor. But I disagree with that. So we just talked about the science begins at the tree, right? If you think about trees growing in the earth from one part of the world versus another, do you think the soil will be the same? The constituents of the soil, the earth, the bacteria that grow in the soil that feed the plants, the sunlight, the amount of wind, the amount of water? These are all variables, and these all change not only the consistency of the plant, but the taste of the bean. So it's something very important to take into consideration, that you are what you eat. And the same thing is true for trees, for all plants. And a cocoa bean that's grown in the Philippines or in Ecuador is gonna taste differently than a cocoa bean that's grown in Tanzania or in South or Central America. So that's really where the flavor begins. But where we, as people, can really have the most impact, it really begins at the fermentation step. So when I say the beans are fermented, it's not an alcoholic fermentation. We're not trying to make alcohol. What we are trying to do is we're trying to convert some of the constituents of the cocoa bean into something flavorful, into something that's palatable, something that we want to eat. And this happens all thanks to bacteria. So the pulp of the cocoa pod, when you cut this open, it's put into a large wooden box. And this large wooden box has generations of bacteria embedded in it. There are spores, there are living bacteria, all kinds of remnants from cocoa pods past. And these bacteria work together to create this biome, much like you would experience within your own body, where it's a living, moving thing. And the bacteria eat the pulp. And in doing so, they create a mesh of enzymes and other molecules that contribute to the flavor of each cacao bean. So to give you guys a more realistic example, has anyone ever had cheese? A nice stinky cheese. Okay, I see people have had stinky cheese. What about dry-aged meat? Dry-aged meat is a great example. So in dry-aged meat, a butcher will butcher a cow usually, and the meat is placed in large pieces in a temperature-controlled chamber. And essentially what happens, much like with cheese, is bacteria grow on the outside of the meat, and they begin to digest the outside. And what they're doing is they're converting that meat. They're converting it into small molecules. And they're doing this via enzymes. And what happens is the molecules, the enzymes that the bacteria produce, dissolve the meat and they fall through. So bacteria, compared to the lattice of the muscle that makes up the meat, are relatively large. But the molecules they produce are small, and they're able to fall through the lattice, the meshwork that's created by the muscle. And as they do, those enzymes are still working, and they're converting, and they're changing the inside of the meat. So at the end of the 20 days or 20 years, however long you're fermenting this meat or this cheese, the bacteria are living on the outside. And the byproducts of their metabolism and the enzymes that they produce have soaked into the meat and have done their job in digesting some of the larger, harder molecules into smaller, more palatable molecules. And that's why if you get a really good aged cheese, like, you can really taste it. I mean, it tastes more like cheese than cheese. The same thing with a steak. If you get a good dry aged steak, it melts in your mouth. And that's all thanks to the bacteria that lived on the outside that were doing all the work for you. And it can be a little unnerving to think about, but when you really get down to it and you start talking about bacteria in the world, you are more bacteria than you are person. Quite literally, your biomass consists mainly of bacteria. So really, more than anything, bacteria should be grossed out by you, because you're really invading them more than they are invading you. Okay, so the fermentation process. The pulp is placed in these large wooden boxes, and the bacteria begin to digest the pulp. And in doing so, they're converting the cocoa bean into palatable molecules that we can taste. But most importantly, they are also, and we'll talk about this a little bit later, so hold on to this. They're also converting the bean to a form that is more palatable for more bacteria. So if I forget about this, somebody would be like, what do you mean that they're making it palatable for more bacteria? I thought that we were the ones eating the chocolate. It's very important that the bacteria like it too. So what we have are these fermented beans. And once this fermentation process has gone on for so long and we're comfortable with the amount of fermentation that has taken place, the beans have been spread out into a cement slab for the drying process. And what this does is this, A, gets rid of the bacteria so that when we eat the chocolate, we're not eating all these bacteria, because even though most of these bacteria are good and benign when ingested by humans, if you get too many of them, they kind of take over and can give you bellyache. So it's a good idea to get rid of the majority of them. Also, when these beans, these fermented beans, are spread out into a large cement pallet, we're drying the beans. The bean itself dries out on the inside, which will come in very handy when we're talking about roasting, because the moisture content will have a profound influence on the roast. So, over a period of time, the beans sit on a warm cement slab, and the sun beats down on them. Dries the beans out, the UV radiation from the sun kills the bacteria, and what we're left with is a nice dry bean that's ready to be shipped. So, the beans are then packaged into large bags, and in the case of our factory, they're sent to us. And we don't use brokers like other chocolate factories might. So we make sure that our beans are not only stored, but they're shipped in the correct manner. Because again, believe it or not, there are a lot of other things that like chocolate just as much as we do. Mold really likes chocolate, because it's full of stuff that mold likes to eat, especially the outside, because the outside is full of nice little micronutrients and other bacteria that the mold would love to get its hands on. On top of that, rodents also have developed a bit of a taste for certain parts of chocolate. And if the beans are stored incorrectly, it can affect the moisture content, which will affect the flavor of the chocolate down the line. So really, every step is vital for the end product of chocolate, for the flavor, for the texture, and of course, for the safety of eating the chocolate. Once the beans are shipped to us, we then can start the process of actually making the chocolate. Before I get into that, are there any questions about what we've talked about so far? Would anybody like to hear anything more about the steps in getting to actually making chocolate?
Can you grow cacao in a greenhouse in the U.S.?
That's a very good question. Yes, you can. In fact, we have somebody in-house that has done it before. And, as I learned today, has made their own small batch chocolate from a Missouri-grown cacao tree, which I must say that as far as I know, that's a first. Missouri chocolate, like actual Missouri-grown and Missouri-produced chocolate. You guys are at least two or three steps ahead of us. Any other questions? The son of the founder of Mars Chocolates actually made this call. And he said that he wanted to not only sequence the genome of chocolate, of cacao, but he also wanted to be publicly available for anyone else who wanted to do research on it, which at the time was unheard of in the private sector, because you know, you'd think that they would want to hold on to it because they would be the only one with the genome sequence. So they would be the only ones with the ability to immediately tell if this chocolate was resistant to this disease and if it was still going to taste good. But surprisingly, they were able to see pretty far in advance to realize that eventually this is going to be a problem. And they were able to tell that if other people weren't going to work on this along with them, they couldn't handle it on their own. And chocolate was going to be something that was either going to become very scarce or may not exist anymore. So they had the foresight to see that it was really better to work together with the other few scientists that were working on chocolate than it was to keep it for themselves and to try and turn a profit on it alone. Yes. Sorry. Okay, got it.
You mentioned earlier that the pulp of the cacao pod is really great. I take it doesn't refrigerate or travel pretty much at all.
Yeah, no. No, it doesn't. In fact, if you'll hand the microphone to my wife right there, she knows a lot about this.
I was just going to add really quickly, there's a lot of FDA regulations that very strictly prohibit importing
very good
actual
point.
Cacao pod and the pulp, which makes it pretty near impossible. So the beans are hard enough, but
yeah.
The pod as a whole is very, very
good. Very good point. Yes? That's a very good question. Okay, so are you talking as far as in line with breeding?
Just how different is it now? Like,
than it used to be?
Than it was when it was very first consumed.
That's a very good point. And that's something that would be hard to answer because a lot of what we get is domesticated because it's, well, okay, let me answer that a little differently. So larger companies like Mars have created what we would consider more domesticated plants. So they have developed plants that are highly resistant to many diseases that have a very high yield and are very small. They're kind of squatty. They reach maturity at a very early age. But when you compare what we consider domestication to what the farmers grow, it is much closer to wild type. And I say that because if you look at something like corn, which used to be teosinte, it's a bush. Corn used to be a bush, and per cob you would get like a few kernels, and they were ugly, and they didn't taste very well. They didn't taste very good. And it has since, you know, evolved into something due to our hands that is very palatable. And you can get a lot of kernels from one cob. And you can get a lot of cobs from one plant. So when you look at it compared to a domesticated crop like corn, it's pretty close. Okay, anything else? Are we ready to move on? All right. So, we have harvested the cacao from the tree. We have fermented the cacao, and we have dried the beans. Sorry, we've harvested the pods, we've fermented the beans, and we've dried them. So what we have is basically a raw cacao bean that we have just received at the doorstep of our factory. So now what do? Are there any coffee drinkers in the house? Yes, that's what I thought. Okay, how many of you can tell a good roast on coffee? Yeah? You? Okay. Has anyone ever had coffee that's over roasted? There you go. What does it taste like? Burned, right? What was the other? Burned and what?
Starbucks.
Starbucks. Okay, yeah. So an over roast, you can tell. It tastes burnt. It's just like the name sounds. If you roast something too much, it's gonna taste burnt. Okay. So, roasting of cocoa or cacao beans is very similar to coffee in that you can over roast it, you can under roast it, and you can roast it just right. So this is a really interesting thing about cacao. Cacao is the bean before it's roasted. After you roast the bean, it becomes cocoa. So if you guys have heard the words cocoa versus cacao, that's the difference. Now, the roast of the cocoa bean is profoundly important to the flavor of the chocolate. Because if you get an over roast, you bet you can taste that in the final product. So, roasting of cocoa or cacao is done at a very specific temperature for a very specific amount of time. And there are multiple ways to do it. And large factories have become pretty good at doing this in mass quantity, but I'm a little biased. I feel you can definitely taste the difference between a bean that's been roasted to perfection by somebody's hands than something that's just been run through a machine. And coffee drinkers, those people who really love coffee, you probably can taste a similar type situation. Under roasting, although you may not be able to tell as easy as over roasting, still has its drawbacks. When you over roast, you get that carbon flavor. It's burned. When you under roast, though, you can get the opposite, where you may not get as much flavor, because a lot of the molecules inside that aren't necessarily digestible, that aren't necessarily palatable, that haven't opened up, they won't be there in the finish. So a perfect roast is really important for you to get the most bang out of your buck. I mean, you've already spent all this time to ferment your beans and to dry them out. It would be a shame to lose all of those flavors that you've been working for in the roasting process. So roasting is very important, and it's important that it's done right. Once the bean has been roasted, which you guys, I believe, should have in front of you, unless you've already eaten them. Okay. If you look at the bean, it's pretty small, probably brown, and it's hard, right? If you guys still have them, what I'd like you to do is take the bean and gently push it between your fingers and roll it back and forth. You notice that the shell begins to come off, right? Okay. That shell is not the part you eat, so you can get rid of it. Yours, if it didn't come with a shell, if you can't roll a shell off, then there might not have been a shell on it. Typically, they have a shell, I promise. Once you roll off the shell, you're left with a naked bean. If you pinch that with your fingers, you should be able to break it. What you're left with there, the roasted inside of the bean, is what we call the cocoa nib. And the cocoa nib is the foundation of chocolate. This is where it all starts. This is gonna have, and yeah, feel free to taste it. This is where it's at. This is where you get the full flavor of chocolate. Before you do taste it, though, I should have warned you, it's pretty intense. It's gonna taste very bitter and astringent. It's gonna suck the spit from your mouth more than a Chilean Cabernet. It's very dry. But if you wanna talk about the health benefits of chocolate, this is where it is. This is where all of your polyphenols, your flavanols, all of your antioxidants are gonna be. These themselves may be a little overpowering, but they make an excellent addition to ice cream, yogurt, salads, cereal, pizza. I mean, you name it. I think we've tried them on just about everything. I know that Lauren's father, the founder of the factory, has literally eaten these on everything he's ever eaten, I think. Because they're really good, and they're really good for you. And there's a lot of literature out there that supports this, so it's definitely worth looking into. I personally love them, but I don't eat as much as I should for the health benefits. Oh, yes?
So if I took all of everybody's beans tonight and I ground them up, would I have cocoa?
That's a good question. You mean
cocoa powder?
Cocoa powder? Yeah. Good question. We're getting to that. I'm glad you asked that. Wow, that was a good question. Okay. So what we have here, the cocoa nibs, is the foundation of chocolate. This is what we're gonna use to actually make the chocolate. So, the cocoa nibs, when ground into tiny, 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 like micron particle size, is what we call cocoa liquor. And we do this via, well, there are a few different ways we can do this. So we can ground them with granite slabs in a machine called a Mullinger, which basically pulverizes the nib. It crushes it into such a fine, tiny, tiny particle size that it creates a paste. And this paste is called cocoa liquor. And this paste is what we're gonna use to go on to make the different ingredients for our chocolate and cocoa powder. So, believe it or not, if you crush this up enough, it will turn liquid. You also have to warm it up, as you'll see. You guys are all receiving cocoa liquor right now. It's solid, but if you were able to warm it up a little bit, you would see that it would liquefy very quickly. It's not quite as liquid as a butter, but when you heat it, it creates a paste. And this paste is created by crushing this nib into smaller and smaller pieces. It's a very fun chemistry experiment. You can take a solid and crush it up into a liquid. Okay. So you'll notice the cocoa liquor probably tastes a lot like the nib. It's because that's what it is. It tastes pretty good, right? Nice and bitter? Maybe a little bit smoother, not quite as crunchy? All right. That cocoa liquor that you have in your hands, we're gonna set a little bit of the side because that's gonna be an ingredient in our finished chocolate products. The other half, we're gonna do something else with. The other half of that cocoa liquor, we're gonna make into two more things. So, this is where a few chocolate factories diverge, because we're gonna use half of that cocoa liquor to make cocoa butter and cocoa powder. And we can do this mechanically, or we can do this chemically. Chemically, when you're talking about mass production, can be a bit easier. You can add alkali to cocoa liquor and chemically extract the oil so that you're left with cocoa powder and cocoa butter. So, if you separate the oil out of that cocoa liquor, you will be left with cocoa powder. The oil that you extract is cocoa butter. Alternatively, you can use the mechanical method, the old school method, where you can squeeze the oil out of the cocoa liquor and you'll be left with the powder, which is actually what we do in our factory. And it's very unique because there aren't very many cocoa or chocolate makers that make their own cocoa butter because it's cheaper to buy. But we like to do single origin chocolate. So the chocolate you'll try later, the cocoa butter and the cocoa liquor are both from the same group of, the same batch of beans from the same farmers in the same country. Okay, little fun fact about cocoa powder. If you are to go to the grocery store tomorrow or later tonight, whenever, and walk down the cookie aisle and look on the ingredients lists of all those cookies and all of those other packaged preserved products, you will undoubtedly see cocoa powder. Anyone who's ever baked or had a grandma that bakes, you probably know what cocoa powder tastes like. We didn't bring any because it's kind of difficult to measure out, it's kind of difficult to eat, it's a little messy, but I'm sure that a lot of you know what it tastes like. Cocoa powder is used in almost everything, and it's really, really, really good. Also, you can take cocoa powder and mix it with warm milk and make decadent chocolate, hot chocolate. It's wonderful. And it makes really great cocktails too. And it's good garnish. So cocoa powder is all over the place. Cocoa butter is the oil that you separate from the cocoa liquor to make, when you separate the cocoa powder from the cocoa liquor. And fun fact about cocoa butter, Well, I'll get to that here in a second when we talk about actually making chocolate. Okay, so at this point, we have taken our bean, we've roasted it, we have pulverized it to make cocoa liquor, we've separated the cocoa powder from the cocoa butter, so we have now three ingredients from the one bean, right? Okay, now we're gonna make chocolate. Before we make chocolate, are there any questions up to this point?
So you take cocoa liquor,
uh-huh.
You separate the fat out, the cocoa butter, and you have cocoa. And you talked about chemically mixing alkali, that's one way to do that.
Alkali, mm-hmm.
I thought Dutch processed cocoa was mixed with alkali, but regular cocoa that you see doesn't have alkali, or has less maybe, or?
Well, you can do it a number of ways.
Okay.
So, and the processing doesn't just include alkali,
mm-hmm.
but it's a good way to get the process started. And I don't know as much about the alkali processing because I've never been involved in it. Okay, so we're ready to make some chocolate. We have all of our ingredients. You remember I said that if you warm up that cocoa wicker, you can liquefy it? But that's what we're gonna do. So we're gonna put our cocoa wicker in a warming tank. And we're going to put our cocoa butter in a warming tank. And then we're going to add our final ingredients. And that is a little bit of organic cane sugar. We're going to mix all of these together. And we're going to be ready to mold our chocolates. But making chocolates isn't as easy as just mixing the ingredients together and putting them into a mold. One of the most vital stages in making chocolates to get it to last, to get it to look good, and to get it to feel good is tempering. And tempering is very difficult for chocolate because you temper chocolate like you would temper steel. And that cocoa butter, like other fats, crystallizes when it solidifies. So the crystal structure, the crystalline lattice that cocoa butter makes, influences the flavor, the texture, and the shelf life of chocolate. So, cocoa butter crystals can exist in three main states. There are alpha crystals, beta crystals, and gamma crystals. Alpha crystals have a very low melting point. So it doesn't take much temperature to get them to turn back into a liquid. Beta crystals have a higher melting point, and gamma crystals have a very high melting point. So if you were to choose between alpha, beta, and gamma in making chocolate, what crystal would you choose? Does anybody care to take a stab at it? So alpha have a low melting point, gamma have a high, and beta is right in between. Beta? That's good. Gamma? Okay. Why do you guys think gamma? Yeah. We got a taker. Go ahead.
I have two reasons.
Okay.
So, from your mouth, not in your hand.
That's a good one. That's a really good one.
It's probably easier to ship.
Yep.
You don't have to refrigerate it, maybe.
That's another really good one. Okay. Anyone have another guess? Alpha, beta, or gamma? Are we going to go with gamma? Okay, well, given the information I just gave you, I'd have going with gamma, too. Because if you think about it, if you want your chocolate to last, you want it to have a high melting point, which means it would have a high shelf life. But I said I was leading you, it's true. There's actually another form called beta prime crystals. So There are some characteristics about chocolate that connoisseurs really look for. And that is the texture and the break. So, alpha crystals, as I said, have a very low melting point. That means exactly what you said, temperature control. So, if your crystals have a low melting point, That means they're going to liquefy at a lower temperature, which means that they will be less resistant to higher temperatures. So alpha crystals melt pretty far below body temp, and they can begin to migrate at around room temperature. And this creates, in chocolate, what's known as fat migration. And fat migration is essentially when the chocolate comes out of solution, and you can visibly see it on the bar. You can see, and yeah, some of you guys have probably seen this before, you can see the fat begin to move around in the bar, and it creates little veins because it wants to stick to itself. It wants to get away from the sugar, and it wants to get away from all the powder within the cocoa liquor and just stick with its buddies. Gamma crystals are really good for long shelf life. Because if you think about that, if you have a nice solid crystalline structure, it's gonna last for a long time. But it affects the flavor, and most importantly, it affects the texture. If you think about something that's real solid, I mean, do you typically think of chocolate as being real hard? I mean, not really, right? You think of it as being relatively soft. So when you create those harder crystals, it changes the texture. And instead of getting a nice crisp break, you get a crunch almost. Beta crystals are not bad. I mean, they're the closest thing to what you really want. But beta crystals will melt at just a bit above room temperature. And what you want is you want something that's gonna last. And you want something that's gonna be stable. Because even if you have beta crystals in a cool environment, it's not what you typically think, but those molecules are going to be moving no matter what. And over time, those molecules are going to move within proximity, and they're going to begin to coalesce and create those veins. So you want a good shelf life, but you don't want a hard break. And that's where beta prime comes into play. Beta prime crystals, not only do they have a great snap when you break the bar, it gives you that real characteristic chocolate-like crack when you break it, without being in, you know, a hard but beta crystals melt at just above body temperature. So that means they're stable at room temperature, but the most important characteristic of a finely tempered chocolate bar with beta crystals, beta prime crystals, is when you put it on your tongue, it feels cold. That bar is room temperature. But when you put it on your mouth, it feels like it's 50 degrees, like it's been in the fridge. And that's because those beta prime crystals melt just above body temperature. So they are absorbing your body heat at the perfect rate. And it makes that chocolate feel cool and refreshing. And that's something that real chocolate connoisseurs will look for, because that shows that that bar is finely tempered. Okay, so this is where I kind of came into play at the factory. I was an undergraduate at Missouri State University when my wife's family were really getting into making chocolate. And I had taken some organic chemistry, so I was borderline scientifically literate. And we were working on this tempering process. And when we started doing this, there weren't a lot of people making chocolate just from chocolate. And there's a good reason for that. It's because it's really hard to do. It's really hard to temper this perfectly. It's way easier to add a soy lecithin or a preservative or a stabilizer, because you can just throw it together and it's fine. It lasts for a really long time. But the funny thing about preservatives is bacteria don't like to eat them, which, you know, says something to some people. I mean, it depends what camp you're in, but there are a few purists out there that think that, you know, there's a right way to do things, because it's the hard way. And that's the way we do it, is the hard way. So I began to do some reading. And in the 50s and the 60s, cocoa butter was like the holy grail of food. Because if you did it correctly, you could create this crystalline structure and you could make food last. Because it was before preservatives had hit the scene. And you could take something that you could make, something that you could grow, something you didn't have to make in a laboratory. You could put it into food, and you could get it to last on the shelf for a very long time. And when we were faced with tempering, like I said, there weren't a lot of chocolate makers in the world, and they sure as heck weren't trying to share their secrets with us. So I began reading, and there was this journal called the American association of oil chemists that had just volumes of publications done on cocoa butter crystallization. And we were able to put it together just through trial and error and reading as much as we could the correct tempering of chocolate to get this these perfect beta crystals, beta prime crystals. And it has really paid off, which you guys are getting ready to see. Okay, so we've mixed all our ingredients together. We have a perfectly tempered chocolate bar. Now we're ready to mold it. Now luckily, the way that tempering works is, remember I said that we have a different array of crystals, right? So in order to temper this perfectly, we heat everything up to a high temperature so that everything melts away. We're left with just pure liquid. It's in perfect solution between sugar, butter, and cocoa. We're then going to cool it down slowly at a nice even rate. And what we're going to be doing is we're going to be forming a mixture of crystals. We're going to be forming a little bit of alpha, a little bit of gamma, but mostly beta. As we cool and form these crystals, we're then going to heat it back up. We're going to heat it back up to just below our beta prime melting point. And what we're going to be doing is we're going to melt away all of our alpha and beta crystals. So we're going to be stuck with just beta prime, maybe a little bit of gamma. We then cool it again at a nice even rate, and the beta crystals create what's known as a seed crystal. And this seed crystal, because in chemistry, like likes like, is going to propagate beta crystals or beta prime crystals. So with a nice even cooling again, we're going to end up with primarily beta prime crystals, and that is the basis of tempering, is that you heat everything up to liquid, you cool at a rate that promotes your crystal formation that you want, you heat it back up to melt away everything else, and then you repeat the process. And you're going to get a nice firm crystalline lattice of the crystal that you're trying to promote. And that's tempering in a nutshell. It's just unfortunate that if you're off by a tenth of a degree at any point in that, it ruins the whole process. So as you can imagine, there was a lot of trial and error. The great thing about temper is that something in temper stays in temper, for the most part. So when we temper, we form these beta crystal lattices, but we can still keep it liquid. And we can keep it liquid for a prolonged period of time, because these beta crystals are going to take over, and they're going to want to make more, or beta prime crystals are going to want to make more beta prime crystals. We then can run it out of our little chocolate guns, which function similarly to what you guys have probably seen in Charlie the Chocolate Factory, where the guns come and drop the chocolate in the molds. Only we have a guy that does it, but it looks really, really cool. They're going to place the molds on a shaking, on a vibrating table. And the vibrating table is going to shake, and it's going to work all the air bubbles to the top. It's going to create a nice flush contact between the chocolate and the mold. And there's one final step in making chocolate that's very important, and that's cooling. Because we've created this nice lattice of beta prime crystals. But we have to keep that process going, because if it cools too fast, it's going to harden. If it cools too slow, we're going to get more of those alpha crystals. So we run it through a cooling tunnel. And the cooling tunnel is a series of fans and an AC unit, essentially. It keeps a nice, even temperature. Now, if you're looking at a company like Hershey's, they have whole buildings that are devoted to this, like whole temperature-controlled buildings where things are placed in freezers and fridges on racks, and it's crazy. But we have this little tunnel that, like, three guys can stand beside and watch the chocolate go through. We then put it on racks, and then each bar is hand-packaged by one of our production people and placed inside a biodegradable plastic bag, inside the biodegradable packaging, and then tied up with a string that was taken from the bag of beans that was shipped to us initially. So we really try to keep everything going for full circle. Okay, questions?
So if you have a batch that gets overcooked, or you know, if you have a off a degree or whatever, what do you do with that?
That's the beauty of chocolate at that point. You can just warm it back up and start all over. Because if you warm it up past that point of gamma crystal formation, you can liquefy it. You can start all over again. Which was, yeah, luckily we didn't spend a fortune doing that because you can always remelt chocolate. Yeah?
So where does the second round of bacteria
come from? Oh, excellent question. Thank you. Okay. Are you familiar with the microbiome? The microbiome is like what I said earlier, that we are more bacteria, really, than we are a person. Because, as far as biomass goes, I mean, we are very much bacteria. For a long time, scientists have been trying to figure out, how does our body use these compounds in chocolate? How are these things good for us? Because we can measure what we eat and what we don't process. And it's been really difficult for us to pinpoint, like, is it the antioxidants? Is it the flavanols? Is it the polyphenols? And as it turns out, it's not us. It's bacteria. The bacteria in our guts love chocolate. And they love all of the things that chocolate makes. And these bacteria are eating the chocolate, and they're producing things that are really good for us. So that's where the bacteria come in, because bacteria like the chocolate that the other bacteria help make, which really fuels us and does a majority of the good in our bodies that chocolate does. Thanks for asking. I completely forgotten. Yes?
Right. So when I'm in the field working in India or Bangladesh or places like that, when you get chocolate there, there's often a white film on the outside of it. Is that the cocoa butter coming out, or is that something else?
That most likely would be the cocoa butter. It could also be something known as bloom, which is the sugar. So it depends on the cocoa butter crystallization and the moisture. Typically, high moisture is more associated with bloom, which is chocolate, because moisture will leach chocolate out. On the other side, though, if it doesn't have a great temper, then yes, it will pull fat out. But most chocolate bars have enough stabilizer in them to where it kind of keeps the fat nice and rigid. It's usually the sugar that you would see a lot of that. Okay.
I have a question.
Oh.
you described this process, it sounds like 100% chocolate. But I wonder, how does dairy and the dairy fat, how does that mix into making a chocolate bar with tempering?
That's a good question.
Does that not change anything?
So, it's a very good question, actually. In our chocolate bars, go ahead.
One other question. Why did they use milk? Why not, I don't know, when, do you know the history of it? Did they try out, like, and is it only cow's milk? Do they use, like, sheep milk?
Another good question.
You can answer whatever or not.
Yeah. Okay, so the chocolate bar you're getting ready to try is dairy-free. There is no milk. I mean, there's cocoa butter, but that didn't come from a cow. So what you're talking about is milk chocolate. It's different than dark chocolate. And there are other forms of milk you can use. For instance, in our milk chocolate, we use goat's milk, and it starts as a powder. So it's powdered goat's milk. And what was the other question? I feel like there was one more. Oh, why did they use cows? I'm not sure.
Well, the thing I just now thought of is when you see something that says 70% dark, I always thought that meant it was 30% dairy.
I mean, that's a good inference. So our bars are 70% chocolate and 30% sugar. Most chocolate on the market, especially milk chocolate, is going to be upwards from 80 to 90% sugar. And maybe just a few percent chocolate, and then the rest milk, or whatever else they put in it.
Sometimes when you look at the bars, it'll say 70, 85% cacao, I guess, and other times it will say cocoa. Does that mean that the one that says, like I have one now that says 85% cacao.
Uh-huh.
Does that mean that it wasn't roasted?
That's a good question. I can't speak for all chocolate bars, but I would say no. Because if you have raw cacao, well, first of all, you remember what I said about all the bacteria and whatnot that exists in raw cacao? So I've never tried to make a bar from raw cacao, but I imagine it would be difficult. And you run the risk of making people sick. But I might defer this question to Lauren, because I think that she has actually had this question a lot.
But to go back to your original question too, the percentage on a chocolate bar indicates the cocoa content or how dark the chocolate is. So like Scott was saying, we range from 70 to 77%. And for our dark chocolate, that means it's 77% cocoa content, which is the cocoa mass, the cocoa liquor, cocoa butter. The rest of it is the sugar. With the milk chocolate, it does change the process, actually. Even though we use a goat's milk powder, it does make it more difficult to introduce another ingredient like that, especially when it comes to a tempura process. And then regarding cacao, that's just a marketing miscommunication. So there are raw chocolates that you can buy. I advise people to be careful when they're eating them, because we're one of the very, very few factories in the world that tests our raw cocoa beans when they're shipped to our factory before they're roasted, which we keep very separate from everything else in the factory. And because they're organic, there can be some dangerous stuff involved that you get rid of during the roasting process. But generally, anytime you're seeing cacao powder or 70% cacao, it's just, it should be cocoa.
I just have one more question. Without getting into the politics of sugar, right, it's really, they all say that they have sugar alcohol. So my question is, one, what's sugar alcohol? Does it have bioavailability, or does it, do you know anything about it, and how difficult is it to work with that? And two, have you ever used artificial sweeteners or tried to use artificial sweeteners in any of these products? Because I've never seen a chocolate that was made with artificial sweeteners.
Yeah, you know, that's a really good question. We've never tried to use sugar alcohol or artificial sweeteners, and I don't know enough about sugar alcohol to really comment. I'm sorry. Maybe our in-house chemist can tell us a little bit about that.
We do make one bar with coconut sugar, but it's as an additive rather than alternative. We use organic cane sugar. And while we have experimented with alternatives, we have not been able ever to achieve from a flavor standpoint anything that we feel like is acceptable from the gourmet craft chocolate perspective, which is what we do. But there are some people playing with it, and I suspect that soon there will be some high-end craft chocolate that has an alternative that will taste really great.
Just as a side note, since you're put on the spot, so most alcohols are just shorter chain carbons than sugars that are hydroxyl groups. The sugars have hydroxyl groups, so I don't know what that is.
All right. Any more questions, or should we get to actually tasting some chocolate? One more? All right. Oh. Okay.
I didn't think anybody would raise their hand to get in the way of tasting.
What exactly is white chocolate?
White chocolate will be chocolate minus the cocoa liquor. So white chocolate, true white chocolate, is going to be cocoa, is going to have a large proportion of cocoa butter. But that's not necessarily always the case. In fact, a lot of people market their products as white chocolate when it in fact is not. Because it has to be over a certain percentage of actual cocoa or cacao to be considered chocolate. And in order to do that with white chocolate, you would have to use cocoa butter, a high percentage of cocoa butter. I'm not sure what that percentage is. Is it 33%? So you'd have to have at least 33% of the bar to be actual cocoa butter in order for it to be considered white chocolate. All right, so we're ready to get on to the good part? Okay, we're actually gonna try chocolate, yes. All right, so she's handing out the chocolate. Before you guys eat it, please allow me to go through the fancy tasting process. And we'll all do this together. Because there is, in fact, a very cool way that you can taste chocolate and be able to pick up on a lot of the more subtle flavors, some of the more underlying tones and textures. All right, this is 70% dark chocolate. The origin is San Jose del Tambo. And here is what we're going to do. Before you guys put it in your mouth, I'm gonna go through the process. First thing you're gonna do is you're gonna look at it. You're gonna notice the sheen. You're gonna notice any textures you can see. You're gonna notice that there's none of the bloom or the fat migration. It should have a nice, soft, almost reflective finish. You're then gonna smell it. Take a nice deep breath. Really get the feel of the chocolate. Okay, now don't do this yet, because I'm gonna walk you through the tasting. When we do start tasting, you're gonna put it in your mouth, and you're gonna take two really quick chews, just to kind of open it up. So one or two bites to kind of break up the chocolate. You're then gonna push it against the roof of your mouth with your tongue and let it sit there for a couple seconds. Let it melt and let the aroma reach your palate and let a lot of those flavors open up. You're then gonna start to chew slowly and take a nice deep breath and let that saturate your nose and your palate. And then you can chew and swallow. Okay, are you ready? Okay, so you guys have already looked at it and smelled, I'm sure. Okay, so go ahead, let's do it. Chew once or twice. Stick it to the roof of your mouth. And then go ahead and chew and... All right, what do you guys taste?
Cherry.
Cherry, that's good. That's one of the things I was gonna say. What do you think about the texture? Smooth, right? I love this bar for its smoothness. What else are you guys getting? What about the finish? A little bitter. Okay, good, good. That's a good one, blueberry. Yeah, a lot of dark fruits, maybe some tannins. I think this is really great because I think this is the part where people can get really creative because there are so many great descriptions of what chocolate tastes like. It's really like wine or like, you know, like a good cheese. There are just so many different things that it can taste like. And a lot of that is not only influenced by the processing, the process that it goes through, but also the soil on which it is grown. I mean, you could take a tree, the exact same tree, family of tree, growing in the Davao Philippines, and compare it with the exact same tree grown in Tanzania, and you can taste the difference. It's almost like you can taste the earth, like the planet, what produced it. Okay, so now that you guys have done the tasting once, we're gonna taste something a little different. We're gonna taste Hershey's Special Dark, and we're gonna do a little compare and contrast. So I want you guys to taste it the same way we just tasted this bar. So you will check it out, have a look, give it a smell, Oh yeah, if you have water, I highly suggest taking a sip of water and cleansing your palate between chocolate bars. We don't need to cleanse with a lemon and a glass of milk. Water will be perfectly fine for this. Okay, looks like everybody has it. So, what does it look like? That doesn't look bad. Maybe a little, just a tad cloudy, but it's still good. It smells like we would typically consider chocolate to smell like, right? Maybe a little sugary. Okay, let's do this. All right, what do you guys think? Cinnamon? I can see that. Sugar, that's a big one. What do you guys think of the texture? It's a little waxy maybe. Cocoa butter, interestingly enough, I don't think this bar has any cocoa butter. Oh, speaking of which, should we taste cocoa butter? I might have skipped over that. We did? Okay, cool. Okay, so what do you guys think the first ingredient on this bar is?
Sugar.
Good guess. I don't know the actual percentage, but I've heard rumors that it's very, very high, upwards of 90%.
So what is semi-sweet chocolate doesn't have a standard. Is there any standardization of what semi-sweet chocolate is when it comes to sugar?
No, not really. I mean, again, it's more of a marketing thing than an actual set value. When working in food, it's really amazing how much of the things that you read, like all natural, that are absolutely a marketing ploy. For instance, if you get like any boxed food that says all natural, so it doesn't have MSG or MSG-free, but it has yeast extract, which is all natural because they took it from yeast, but is full of glutamate, which is, you know, what you're trying to avoid by getting MSG-free. Yeah, it's really, really fascinating. Okay, so we've got one more to taste. This one is going to be a little bit darker. It is our Dabal Philippines bar. And it is 77% cocoa, or cacao, however you want to look at it. And again, if you have a glass of water, it's not a bad idea to take a sip in between tastes. Okay. Looks like we are ready. All right, so again, a pretty even, nice little sheen to it. It smells darker than the last one, right? To me, this one smells really dark. Do you guys notice anything else in the smell? Do you smell anything other than chocolate? I can't smell very well, so I'm not as good at this part. What's that?
It smells more like the bean.
Smells more like the bean. That's great, yeah. I can smell that. Okay, let's do this. Ready? Immediately, what do you guys notice about the texture?
Harder.
We'll go harder.
Doesn't melt.
Yep, doesn't, does it? Mm-hmm. Yeah. It really doesn't taste as sweet as it smells. That's really good. What kind of flavors are you guys getting?
Alcohol.
Alcohol. That's a good one. I think somebody else said that too. What about the finish? This is the kicker. What do you guys get on the finish?
Tastes like nibs.
Tastes like nibs? I get a little bit of honey on the finish. Just like a touch of honey. Good. Wood, yeah, that's a good one. Cedar, All right, cool. This is good. Well, guys, now that you've tried the finished product and persevered this journey with me, are there any other questions? Any finishing things that you would like to know more about? Yes.
Where are you selling your chocolate?
Askinosie Chocolate is available at Clover's and also Hy-Vee on the south side.
Excellent.
Any other questions? Nope. Up here in front.
Now that we can grow cacao in Missouri, when are you going to start growing your own cultivar?
I think that you need to speak to this woman behind you right here. They're years ahead of us.
Well, do you think that that might be, 100 years in the future, that'll be a thing?
That's a really good question.
Why wouldn't Mars already have done this?
They're trying.
Oh.
From what I understand, from what I heard through my guy, Ed Seguine, they have managed to push the boundary a little bit and to actually get things to grow on their own, not being in a greenhouse, not under constant care, but they haven't pushed it very far. Yeah. Though I've tried growing them before and I couldn't do it. So the two seedlings. Okay, yeah, so you need to talk to her. She's way better at it. Yes?
Between cacao that comes from different countries that are producers in the world, if there's any, broad category.
That's a good question. And from what I know, from like just the bare plants and molecular aspect of it, what's in the soil is going to make a huge difference on how the production of the bean. And they're also exposed to different environmental factors, which are going to influence the taste of the bean. And they are also going to be associated with different bacteria in the soil that are going to be influencing the taste of the bean. But even more importantly, when you start talking about different regions of the world, you start talking about different families of cacao. So there is so much of a genetic separation between them. They're going to producing different levels of different proteins that are going to heavily influence the flavor. Now, if you were to take the exact same tree, or maybe a sibling of the tree, and grow it in a different part of the world, you'd be able to taste the differences just in the environment. But when you start talking about a chocolate that you tasted from Davao, for instance, versus Del Tombo, you're tasting so many differences. You're tasting different farming practices, different soil, different environmental factors, but you're also tasting a complete different family of tree. So it's really difficult to pinpoint in each region like what flavors to expect because there are just so many variables. I'm sure that people have tried to do it, kind of like they do with wine. You can say that, France is always like this, or California is always like this, but I feel like even in wine, people are really pushing the envelope because, 100 or even 50 years ago, they said California will never produce wines as good as France. And now we have Camus, and we have, Sutter Homes. no, I'm thinking Silver Oak. Yeah.
So have people looked at how different bacterial inoculations adjust the flavor profiles of chocolates?
That's a good question. I don't know. I think that Ed Seguine, the guy that I spoke about earlier, I think he had a friend that was working a little bit with that, but I don't know how it turned out. I do know that different farms will have different species of bacteria even. So even if you have farms that are close together, based on, you know, the type of inoculum that started in that wooden box however many years ago, it's going to be different from neighboring farms. That's a really good question, and I think that that's something that the more we look into the microbiome and the more that we look into the different strains of bacteria that influence flavor, it's something we're going to learn more about. In fact, there was a speaker that spoke at Mizzou about a month ago who was working on that exact thing in cheese, and they found something really interesting. So they were working with the different strains of bacteria in caves that produce different flavors of cheese, trying to figure out, okay, why does this bacteria only grow on the rind? Why does this bacteria only grow on the inside of the rind? Why does this bacteria not grow on the cheese at all? Trying to understand, like, which bacteria contributed to which flavor. And what they found was that they were seeing bacteria from the other side of the world. They were seeing bacteria that only existed in the depths of the ocean. And what they found out was they could never reproduce this. They would try to take it to the lab and they could never reproduce these strains of bacteria because people were introducing things like sea salt. And the sea, you put sea salt in the cave to help control the conditions. And believe it or not, there were bacteria that were surviving in the dried sea salt and being transferred to the cheese and thriving in the cheese and really making the cheese. So I think that that is a question that people are working on but is yet to be answered. And I think that will be, you know, at the heart of all, at the heart of a lot of the flavors that we see in chocolate. And like I said, with the microbiome, at the heart of why chocolate is so good for us in the first place.
So I guess the second part of that question, I don't know, you led to this being Are the biomes in each set of boxes that they ship in so unique that they're essentially very, very difficult to replicate?
That's a really good question. I know that they're unique. And that's all I know. Actually, before we move on, I think Warren might know a little bit more about that than I do.
I do not know how to answer that question, other than to say that the beans are fermented in those fermentation boxes, but once they're dried, you're put in those burlap sacks and that's what they're shipped into.
So what's the deal with the FDA? Why won't they, I mean, if this thing's so good, why won't they let us just record it?
That's a good question. I think Warren might know, do you know about that? The only thing I can assume is that because of, you know how it's really difficult to, you know, transport animals and plants on your own. I think that they're worried about people bringing in diseases and pests, especially, that will take over and destroy a lot of our crops. I mean, even if there isn't maybe a lot of, even if there weren't scientific merit for it, I think it's kind of a better safe than sorry type scenario, but I don't know that for a fact.
Yes, I mean, that is the reasoning. But I mean, great question. I would love to know. What's up with the FDA half the time? right, that's the idea. But I mean, it's really unbelievable, even just the importation of the grains, the links that we have to go through, and the amount of time that it takes, and the places that they sit to be inspected. They're worried about a lot of things. So, what would you worry more about?
What kind of wood did they use for the wooden box? I was just curious because maybe that influences the bacteria.
That's a really good point. I think that the type of wood varies from region to region. I'm not as familiar with the types of wood that they have, but I mean, I don't know. Do they use wood that's made out of the cacao tree? That would seem very fitting, but probably not since they're typically not as tough. Yeah, I don't know. That's a really good question. Something else to look for, or to look forward to learning about.
It varies based on the region and just what they have available. And they make them themselves. So everything from balsa to, I'm not even sure. I was just in Tanzania a few months ago and we asked what the wood was and I didn't understand. But I mean, in some cases too, they're lined with banana leaves and all of those things contribute to this really important fermentation process. affects the flavor tremendously.
All right. Anything else?
All right. If there's nothing else, let's everybody thank Scott.
Thank all of you. Wonderful questions. This was a lot of fun. I love the questions.
You must think this is a hazing ritual for the graduate students because it's one of the longest science cafes we've had so far. I just want to remind everybody about our Facebook page, Science Cafe Columbia. If you have a Facebook account, just go in the search bar and search for Science Cafe Columbia. It'll come up immediately. Feel free to go there. Our next several topics should be up soon. Feel free to leave us a comment, suggestion, hate mail, whatever you want to do there. And then secondly, I want to thank everybody for coming, sincerely. We love having Science Cafe, and welcome back, and we'll hope to see you in the future.